Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Dedro, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Brad Robinson and Frank Dispensa with Kane & Weiner. Brad, a graduate of the University of Colorado, has been in accounts receivable management industry for over 25 years and has a long history of proven results in the executive sales management and strategic business development area. He began his AR career with a major insurance provider, and he later transitioned into a sales management role focusing on training and coaching skills and execution towards greater results and leadership. His training and public speaking seminars for industry groups and clients only further his passion for the AR industry. Frank has been active in the credit information and commercial debt collections industry for the past 30 plus years, holding positions in customer service and education, sales, collections, and general management. In his role as Vice President, Client Operations makes him responsible for management of all client relations activities, as well as association and client satisfaction strategies. Working closely with collection management is one of his top priorities to ensure clients are receiving the highest level of overall service. He earned his Certified Commercial Collector designation by the International Association of Commercial Collectors, Inc., and has been a member of the Commercial Law League of America. Frank holds a Bachelor's of Art degree with majors in Business Administration and Psychology, and a Master's degree of Business Administration with concentrations in Marketing and Human Resource Management. Celebrating their 90 years in business this June, Kane & Weiner is a clear industry leader and sets the standards for AR management. Business owners are faced with delinquent accounts receivable accounts often contemplate the best course of action to take for payment recovery. In today's Industry Insider webinar, we'll discuss traps, tricks, and tactics every staffing professional should know, including 5 rules in accounts receivable process, top 7 traps staffing companies should avoid, when you should negotiate, service provider versus finance relationship, why age is powerful, and when to place in collections. By the end of this session, you'll know the traps and how tips to get paid on time. If you have any questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat feature. And after the presentation, we'll have some time for questions. With that, I will turn the floor over to Brad.
Wow, that's good stuff. thank you. This is Brad Robinson, and Amanda, thank you very much for that introduction of not only myself, but the organization, but I actually learned something about my colleague. I guess I should pay greater attention to the submissions interrelated to his qualifications. I feel, wow, Frank, congratulations.
well, thank you, Mr. Robinson. it's exciting to be here today with the folks, and we appreciate the opportunity.
Yep. So before we start off, one of the things that I would like to encourage everybody to do because of the uniqueness of this situation is you know, if you have a question, you have the options within the WebEx environment to send a message over. We're going to have some polling questions, and if everybody can participate in that, that's really going to help us too, because, you know, if we were standing up in a room right now, I guess there'd be a little bit of stage fright, possibly. But I think majority of us are comfortably in our domestic environments with maybe one or two that are actually in a work environment, a natural commercial space, I'll call it. So your participation even in this environment through the WebEx format in an audio setting is really kind of important for us as presenters to help it kind of keep it fluid, because we're going to go for an hour. We're not going to go over an hour. It's only scheduled for 1 hour. So you know when this thing will end. I guarantee you that. We're going to leave room for questions and answers at the end. So thank you very much. And I guess here we go. Amanda, do I have the controls?
Yes, you do. Go ahead.
Fantastic. So once again, this is really related to the best practices from a collection agency perspective. Frank and I will share with you our experiences aligned with the clients that we have. We will share with you our expertise associated with what we see on a day-to-day basis. The goal is to really apply that knowledge and give you some tips and assist you with your internal processes without getting down into the details. So at any point throughout, if we don't answer something that's near and dear to your heart, at the end, you will have our contact information. Feel free to reach out to us at that point, but we'll try our best to cover at a high level some very important things. And of course, we can't ignore the obvious. We are in a unique environment right now, and so we labeled this best practices for delinquent accounts, and now we had to add in there before, during, and hopefully after the coronavirus crisis. We took some liberties here to utilize the mask, which is seems to be pretty common in my town. I actually live in Boise, Idaho, and I used to travel quite a bit, and that stopped. But even in my city, I see quite a few people with face masks. Frank is coming to you from Chicago. So as we move on, Amanda already talked about this, so I don't want to go too far into this. But we're going to hit the five rules, the seven traps. We're going to talk briefly about when to negotiate and, frankly, when to not negotiate. We're going to talk about what you are versus what your customers sometimes want you to be, which is they probably want you to be a bank with no finance charges. And then the biggie for us, and you're going to see a consistent theme throughout the process, is the age, when an account ages and the complexities associated with that. And last but not least, we're going to wrap it up when we go, when should I ever place it with a third-party agency? So as we transition in, I'm going to hand it off to my partner to speak for this first part. So, Frank, I believe we may have a poll question to start out, or no? Never mind. We're going to wait.
We're almost there, Brad, where we'll ask some feedback from the group. But thanks, Brad. Yes. Speaking on in reference to the first bullet point, you know, I first came into the business back in 1993. And from that period forward, we had seen, you know, we've seen some ups and downs when it comes to this particular industry. Most people think that when times get tough, that's really good for companies like ours. And to a degree, that's not necessarily true, because what ends up happening in tough times is that businesses and people struggle sometimes with money. So we actually flourish when the economy is very good, and when creditors are essentially have business coming in, they don't have a lot of time to spend on it, and therefore they have to move things through the process. What I will say has changed over the last 25, 30 years, especially after the 2008 crash that we saw, was that there was a pretty significant change in the way that we had seen people communicate with their customer base. And what it really became a push for was, how can we do things different and better? And how can we become more proactive with our customers in order to make sure that we are catching things, problems, as early as possible? So one of the biggest things that we can recommend at this point is that you have a very proactive approach to communicating with your customers. You know, some customers that we deal with know their customer base very well, and that is a very good thing. But sometimes you have a very large customer base, and it's difficult to know your customers really well. And that puts you in a place where you have to figure out other ways that you can become proactively communicating with your customer base. but we cannot stress it enough that figuring out a way that you can really get involved sooner than later is a way to certainly hedge off any future problems that you may have with your customers. So with that, Mr. Robinson, I think we were going to pop over to the policies and procedures, and we were going to do a poll.
Okay, so the poll is open. Please go ahead and answer. Hang on one second. I think we got the wrong one open. Wrong tab. Sorry about that. Let's try this again. Okay, so the poll is open here. You should be seeing this on your screen. Do you have a formalized written AR policy? So if you can answer yes or no.
And this is where we should have the Jeopardy music, right, Amanda?
Mm-hmm.
While the poll is being essentially calculated, let me just make a comment. There's a couple of different things that I'm thinking of with policies and procedures. Number one, and this may sound very fundamental, but from a policy perspective, it's critical that your customers understand what your terms are. And you know, that sounds very basic and fundamental, but you would be surprised how many times we see problems down the road, and it's because they do not understand what exactly they were supposed to be doing from a payment perspective. So it's really important from what you're doing that your customers understand how they're supposed to be paying you. That's the first critical piece from my perspective on a policy and procedure. Then we're going to switch a little bit over after we get the results here to talk more about internally having an AR policy. So, Amanda, I don't know how long we give it 5 minutes and then we do the poll.
I'm pulling it up now. We won't give them the full 5 minutes since we've got a few. So
okay.
Enter your submissions right away. It's closing out. And then I will go ahead and
along the lines of being proactive and your customers understanding your terms, let me tell you something from our perspective. I would say to you 65% of the accounts that come through our doors are often disputed situations. And if you can be proactive with your customers as early as you can identify those disputed cases and therefore save yourself some headaches. And there we go. We've got the results. So let's see here.
So you half of the audience, Frank, answered they do not have a formalized written AR policy.
So, and thank you very much. And I will tell you that those results are fairly typical from what we see. What I recommend to our customers is it's really important that you create an AR policy and how you are going to handle your AR, and that it be in writing, because it puts everybody on the same page with understanding what needs to be done when you start to have a problem with an account. And just some things that we've done in our world, so to speak, to help manage the receivables. When we created our policy, we also created clear delineations of who is responsible for contacting certain customers that have AR issues. So we have different AR representatives that are responsible for keeping track of the customer base. So having somebody that's responsible for it is key. Making sure that you have an accurate tracking system that can notate, what has been done with an account that is potentially a problem. So that gives you an opportunity to notate the account, know what information such as invoicing that may have been sent to them. It's critical to have that tracking system so that anybody who sits in a chair wants to open up the computer and take a look at the history of an account can tell what has been happening. What we also really recommend is that people have, and Brad is probably going to touch, we're going to talk about notices, I think, in not too distant future here, notifying, sending notices out to your customers that an invoice is due. It's very critical that in that period, in that process, that you build what we classify as escalation, where things are essentially friendly reminders to begin with, to where they become more forceful in telling people if they don't do what you need them to do, i.e. pay their bill, then there are consequences to that. So that is what we have, or what I have at the moment, on policies and procedures. Moving on, staying consistent, timely, and factual. I think that that also goes into the point that notation is key, so that you know exactly what is going on with your customers and what you have done with their accounts. This one is kind of a big one right now. Exercising empathy in all communications, verbal and written. What I will tell you is, having been in the business since 93, this, over the past 60 days, has been an unprecedented time for all of us as far as what we're doing and how we're communicating, not only with our customers, but, you know, with the debtors that we are dealing with who owe money. And so, Brad, I think we were thinking about asking the group a question, and the question essentially was, take a look.
Okay, so we've got the next poll up for about 30 seconds here. In response to current events, have you reviewed or made changes to your AR policy in the last 60 days? Yes, no, or need to?
Well, there's half of them that don't have a policy, so they probably haven't changed it. But while we're waiting for those results, there's an acronym up here. It says formerly NEAT. That is an acronym that I learned years ago from a training mentor of mine. His name is Tom Black. And so all credit to him, but it stands for No Excuses Accepted Today. And this is that part of our introductory where we talked about before, during, and after the coronavirus. This was seriously a before statement. There's no excuses. I have an invoice. I supplied you with staffing. You owe us money, and it was due, and I need it. Well, what we've seen in this current environment is a dynamic shift, even from a third-party collection agency side, where what Frank just spoke about is the importance of exercising empathy in all of our communications. It's not going to get us anywhere to ignore the current events. This takes place in our world in many fashions. It can happen in a natural disaster within a certain location, part of the country, where we will cease our collection activity for a period of time during that natural disaster, let's say a hurricane in the south, or an earthquake in a particular part of the country, or a tornado. We take pride in making sure we understand what's going on in the economy. And obviously, globally for us, all of us now, we're all being impacted. So, you know, that ability will open up channels for us to be paid quicker at all levels. So if you hadn't before, this might be the time to do it. But certainly, it's not going to be a hard, fast, you owe us money, sorry, I don't care what's going on. You know, if it works for your business, I understand that, but we are encouraging our staff and our clients when we're being asked about how we're managing it. We are showing a lot more empathy in all of our communications and going forward. So, do we have the poll results?
Yeah, I do see them there. There's 75% no, 25% yes. And I, you know what, I will say this too, and Brad will attest to this. We have spent a big chunk of time over the past 60 days contacting our clients, our customers that we deal with. And it kind of circles back to bullet point number one, where you're being proactive in your communication with your customers, because we're calling them to say, how are you doing during this period of time? And it's quite amazing the response level we're getting from our customers, who are often working remote. They may have time on their hands now more than they did before. and they are willing to talk to us. And it really kind of, it helps build that bond and the relationship that you have with your customers. So, you know, and we continue on that initiative at this point in time. So it's a good way to get to know your customer base. And then the more you know them, the better off you're going to be. That's good, Brad. You can move on. And now I think we're going to let Mr. Robinson, Bradley, shift over and talk about.
Yeah, and as I transition to the next slide, does anybody have any questions that they would like to pose interrelated to the AR process and policies and procedures? Once again, feel free to type it in the chat. We can stop at any moment and answer those questions, okay? To keep the dialogue going back and forth, don't be shy, please. If you have questions, please let us know. And use that format off to the right. We'd be grateful. That way we also know that hopefully we're talking about something that's critically important to you and your organizations. I'm going to move along to the next slide, and it's not too late to ask us any questions about the others. But as I move forward, you know, we find common areas that our clients get themselves in trouble. And what do I mean by that? Well, by the time we get the file, you know, we are a recovery agency. In many ways, we are a salvage yard, for lack of a better term. We don't have a magic wand. We are very professional in what we do. We're skilled, highly skilled in negotiation, debtor locating, debtor discussions, and moving them from a non-paying environment into a paying mode. So that's what we do. We're skilled at it. We've been doing it for many, many years. Our top producers are very well crafted in their environment. But at the end of the day, if somebody can't pay or won't pay, they're not going to pay. All we can do is lean on them, use leverage that we have interrelated to credit reporting, legal terms and all that. So, but what we find sometimes is that the clients have done things to make our job even harder and their job even harder. So some of these things that we're going to talk about right now interrelate to even what Frank just discussed. The first and most important is, do you have a written agreement? Do you have something signed off by your client that's verifiable and has the value of the letter of the language within it? You know, there's services out there now. You may have an attorney. You may have an agreement. Is it an old agreement? You might want to really read into it all the way down to, we have clients that will call us and say, I want to add collection fees. I want my collection fees added. Well, because of the way the law works, we're not allowed to add collection fees. We can add interest, but unless it's specifically stated in the contract, it becomes very difficult for majority of states for us to add any collection cost, and it has to be laid out like that. So we strongly suggest that every interaction that you have go beyond a handshake or just a simple email interaction. Well, some people will say, well, verbal agreement's an agreement. True. However, try to prove that in the court when they're telling a different story. But if you have something in writing with the signature of an authorized signer, which is also important, we strongly suggest that if you don't have one incorporated, that you work toward getting a written agreement with all of your customers. Even customers you've dealt with in the past that may be currently billing and they pay on time, we still encourage you, because everybody runs into situations down the road. The second bullet here is, fool me once, shame on who? You. Fool me twice, shame on me. What we mean by this is the broken promise. We're going to talk about age over and over and over. But how many times have you been asked, and this is not a poll question, this is just a sidebar, have you been asked to just give, I need 30 more days. They're doing okay, but I'll pay you in 30 days. I need two more weeks. I need two, and then all of a sudden that time comes and it goes. Broken promises continue to become continued broken promises. They don't just happen once typically. They happen again and again and again. So once somebody's broken a promise, basically any other deals that you've made with them should go off the table. Don't continue to go down that path. The third one is discontinuing reminders. For those of us who have an AR policy, we know that we're going to send out an invoice and we're going to send out one more and maybe one more. And now they don't pay. don't just cut it off because, well, we only send out two. Well, okay. Maybe you need to implement a new letter at that point. Don't discontinue reminding your customer to pay, because that allows it to grow old, and it's amazing how quickly 30 days, 60 days, 90 days goes by after that final reminder before we're like, oh yeah, they still owe us money. Those reminders not only remind them, but they remind you and your staff internally. And the fourth one is not validating your customers' challenges. If we were sitting in a room right now, I'd have you all raise your hand, yes or no. How many times have you ever heard somebody say, I can't pay you because I haven't been paid yet for X? Or I cannot pay you yet until I get my funding from the bank, or whatever it is. You know what? What we do every time a customer tells us they can't pay, we have a theme and a theory, and I could bring Frank up off of mute here, and we have a statement. Trust, but Frank, this is where you say validate. Validate.
Well, validate or verify.
Yeah, so we want to validate and verify. So anytime there's a question, I'm going to get to that in 2 seconds here, but anytime you're being presented with a financial hardship or a verifiable, I'll call it excuse for this forum, go ahead and verify that. It's okay for us to trust it, but I'm also going to verify it. Lindy, I believe you have a question. I'm going to read it off, but it says, our contract states the net terms, but the payables don't see it and don't really follow the contract that was signed. What do I do with this? It's a great question. So effectively, the way, and Frank, you can jump in here too to help me out with this, but I'm going to answer the first part of it is, you know, anytime you have a signed contract, it really helps you to share that back with them and remind them, you realize we have an agreement, right? And then in your particular case, it says net terms, but the payables, when you say the payables don't see it.
Well, sometimes
the bill.
Yeah, sometimes we have it. For instance, when we're doing business, when we're becoming a vendor, we will essentially make contact and complete some paperwork to be set up as a vendor in that party's system, so that they can cut checks to us when payment has become due. So I think what I would say is make sure it is. As you're going through your onboarding of your customer, you say to them, okay, is there a vendor process that needs to be set up that we need to contact the AP part and complete something so that we can make sure that we are set up for payment? So that would be my recommendation.
And to add on to that, it is possible that like an HR hiring manager might be signing off on the contract with the agency, and they maybe have not shuffled that information down to the AP level, so the terms may not have gotten, you know, down to that level. What I might suggest at that point is if you are talking to AP and they're not following the contract, that you can send them the contract or tell them what the terms are and who signed that agreement, so they can go validate your request for payment according to those terms with whoever approved that on their side.
Great point, Amanda.
Yeah, it's a great point and a great transition, because if you look at our next bullet point, it says dealing with one person, and then it goes on to a title, please. You know, all too often we're assigned a unique individual within an organization who will pay that invoice, right? They have an AP person. You know, it is okay to note that if you've continued to send or continue to communicate with this one person, having some familiarity with either the owner of the company or another hierarchy person within the organization would assist your situation. What do I mean by that? Very often we end up as collectors calling the accounts payable person. Can't get through to them. Guess who we call next? We call the controller. Guess who we call next if we don't get a hold of the controller? We call the CFO. And the reason we do that is through the escalation process. Multiple points of contact within an organization inevitably will get attention a lot quicker than continuing to just call and leave messages with the same person over and over. So if you don't already have a second or third point of contact within the organization of your customer, it's a good idea. And I'm going to say it from not only a bill collection standpoint, but also a sales perspective. What better way to validate your service and who you are is if everybody within the organization, from that person that you're dealing with up and even down channel, knows who you are. Because it only is a matter of time before somebody retires and then they're gone and that was our person who got us in there. Well, if you know multiple people, they'll always be familiar with who your organization is. And at times of accounts receivable, it's nice to have those relationships as well.
Brad, I really like your point on the escalation. I think that's a very valid way to move through a cycle. So definitely something that I would highly recommend. I did have a question for you. When you said to validate the excuse, it frequently we'll hear excuses of, you know, I've not been paid for the project, or I haven't been paid for XYZ, which is why I've not paid you for the invoice. Even though your contract and terms and services do not depend upon that, that is a frequent response we get from customers. So how would you validate whatever their excuse is? Do you have a phrase or a mechanism that would give us something to shoot back at them when they start giving us those type of excuses?
Absolutely, and I know Frank will as well, so I'm going to give you my response first, and I'm sure Frank would want to weigh in on this too. The first thing we will always lean on is that empathy aspect. I understand that. However, our agreement isn't predicated on that value. Our agreement is on the terms of the contract that I have with you, and unfortunately, we need payment. I can't sit there and hope that they're going to pay you. I need you to honor our contract and make sure that I get paid, because they're still paying other bills through other facets for sure. You know, discounting the value of your service and taking a lesser amount in those moments. You know, I'm going to always put this disclaimer up there. You know who your valuable customers are. You know who you want to work with and who you don't want to really start hedging some of your contractual values. So there's not a one size fits all here. So understanding who that customer is to you and your organization is critical. However, to rely on the facts that you have available to you, which is your contract, and you don't say this out loud, but that's not your problem. Your problem is getting paid from that customer at this time. So lean heavily on the agreement that is that you have aligned with that customer. Frank, I believe you might have a statement on this as well.
Well, I mean, I think that I would have said the same thing you said, Brad. What I would say is sometimes it really depends upon the balance that's owed. I mean, we have customers or sometimes will come back to us and say, listen, we're working on getting a loan from the bank. And then we're like, okay, well, can you give me some information? Would you be okay if I were to contact the bank just to confirm that you're working with them to get financing? And, you know, it's a kind of a test question, because, you know what, if they turn around and say no to you, well, that kind of throws up a red flag to me that they're not willing to share that information. And not everybody's going to be willing to share that information with you. I will say that. But you know what? If there's a sizable amount of money out there, you'd be amazed how many people will give us the banking information. We simply call and say, you know, are you working with these folks to provide them with a loan? And we very often will get that information, whether it's true or not. So, but I think that Brad's point is probably the more common way to go, which is essentially, listen, this is not the situation that we set up. We agreed upon this as far as your terms, and you need to do the right thing and stick to paying what we agreed to. That's going to be your first playback on this kind of a situation.
Very good. Thank you. And I see Lindy has the secondary aspect to that. They say they have not been paid by Medicaid, so they cannot pay us. You know, I don't have a lot of the details in legacy history aligned with Medicaid and how that works. But unless it's built into your agreement that payment will be due at a certain time, and also when Medicaid pays them, therefore they can pay you. I would stick with what we just talked about and say, well, my agreement doesn't say anything about you being paid by Medicaid, and I apologize for that situation. We need to be paid. Again, I would really caution that you lean on that relationship value, and because that's a legitimate, that is not even an excuse. That's a legitimate concern that may be in that situation. Having dealt with different situations similar to Medicaid, you know payment's coming. It's just a matter of when. So I would ask that, you know, you lean on the agreement. If it doesn't say anything about Medicaid, maybe they add it in later on so it's clear. But the best that I could tell you from our perspective is stick to the agreement that you have. And provided you don't have an agreement, and they're sharing that with you, what a great opportunity to put it in and maybe get a personal guarantee or some type of guarantee aligned to when Medicaid comes in. They don't have the ability to spend that money before they pay you, meaning effectively they sign that over to you at that time. So it's a good opportunity that you might want to utilize to get a contract in place with that language. Moving along here so we can stay on time is the second to last one is not picking up the phone. It is always amazing to me the number of clients that have said, well, we sent them letters. I'm like, good. Well, you know, actually it helps my business, so I'm grateful that they do that. But my encouragement to this group is if you don't already have a policy, having a, what we call the four-prong approach, don't just choose one approach. If yours is just a simple invoicing, you know, do you have their email address? Or maybe you send it to email. Do you now send the old paper trail, the U.S. mail? So four-prong approach. Here's the first prong approach. Typically, it's billing through traditional U.S. mailing. Second would be emailing. Third would be pick up the phone. Hey, I sent you your invoice, and we haven't heard from you. We're calling you now. And the fourth, which is really gaining momentum, especially in the third-party world, is texting. A lot of the rules have changed. If you look back just 5, 6, 7 years ago, if you didn't dare call somebody on their cell phone. And just a few years back, you didn't dare text them on their cell phone about business related matters. Well, we've had this dynamic shift where not only is it permissible in culture to send somebody a text saying, hey, I need to speak with you about an invoice. Legally, we have found in majority of states that we can actually collect a debt utilizing those values. Now, there are some states, and I don't want to get into the devil of the details, but having that into the agreement as well, that we can communicate with you via these forms interrelated to the contract and the terms and payables can also be built into that agreement. Okay. So last but not least, not sending to collections out of fear. We hear this quite a bit in our sales routine. We're calling a client. They'd like, I have people I'd like to send, but I can't. I cannot send it because of the relationship that we have. I'm going to expedite this. We have different ways to do. We are governed by the FDCPA, the CFPB, the FTC. We have so many governing bodies. What we do is in a professional environment. We don't holler. We don't scream. We don't cuss. We don't make idle threats outside of litigation. We don't do things that are going to get our agency in trouble or our customers in trouble. What we will say to our clients that are fearful of sending somebody to business, we can actually have a soft approach. We can actually say, you know what, our customer appreciates your business. They've attempted to work with you on this. However, they can no longer manage the file. They've asked us to intervene and work with you toward a payment resolution. That's a sensitive, soft approach. So just because you send it to collections, I know there's this big, bad bat theory that lays out there in some of our minds, but in reality, it is a very professional environment. It's an aggressive environment, and we hold true to what we say we're going to do. If we say we're going to sue, we sue. If we say we're going to do something, we do it. We report to credit, so on. So don't be fearful about sending out to collections. So real quick, we're going to run a quick poll question before we go on the next slide. And do you want to read that, Amanda?
Sure. So do you fear sending an account to collections will jeopardize your relationship with the account?
All right. I'm interested in this, and we're going to continue to move on just in the value of time as it relates, and you're going to see some crossover here. So once again, do you fear sending an account to collections will jeopardize your relationship with the account? So as we move on, this really kind of boils into negotiation. You know, we get asked quite often, you know, I don't know, should I negotiate the balance or what should I do here? Well, we do a lot of presentations interrelated to negotiations. Look at that. I like it. I love our responses. 67% say no. Some of them sort of makes total sense. I love that nobody says yes because don't fear it. Because, hey, they did. It's their responsibility. They're the ones who aren't paying the bill. This is a consequence associated with that. So good job, everybody. When should I negotiate? So the never equals fool me once, fool me twice. Remember the slide before? The people who continue to break promises with you, I would strongly encourage you probably not to enter into negotiations of a reduction of a balance there. It's not going to turn out favorable for you in the majority of cases. The people you always want to think about, I'm not saying you should, but at least consider negotiating with, maybe it's terms, maybe it's a little extension, maybe it's a payment plan when it was all supposed to be paid in full, are the clients that have been good. They have a good history. They're desirable growth clients for you. Clients that you know are just running into this, I'm going to even use that Medicaid situation. Somebody who you know favorably, historically has paid you, and this is a very unique situation. Those are the people I would encourage you to negotiate with. And once again, only in verifiable customer challenges. So if somebody says, hey, we've experienced this circumstance, then we say, fantastic, I'm happy to work with you. If you, our company policy, and always lean on this, our company policy requires us to. So I'm going to tell you a little secret about me. I officiate college football. I work for the Pac-12 conference. And a part of our job is to administer football games and apply the rules. Well, sometimes coaches aren't really excited about some of the things that we have to enforce, and occasionally they'll come to us, and my simple response is, coach, by rule, that is a foul. So in this particular case, don't be afraid to lean on that and say, by company policy, if I negotiate and do this, I need to verify your claim. I need you to send me a supporting documentation. It basically takes you out of it in a personal manner and puts it right back on organizational structure. So do we have one more poll question real quick right at this segment? Or am I ahead of myself on this?
I think we're a little ahead of ourselves on that, Frank.
All right, then you take over, Frank. Please.
Okay, we'll move along. Listening to your email was one of the items that we have on there. You know, it's amazing how I've received some emails from folks in my time, and I've read it, and I was, like, for instance, very upset, with what I saw in the content of the email. And then when I picked up the phone and talked to the person, it was a completely different spin of what I was actually reading. So it kind of goes back to Brad was talking about earlier about making sure you speak to your customers, because many times email does not properly capture the tone that's needed or that is true and accurate in relationship to a situation that's going on. So the bottom line is, when in doubt, always pick up the phone and talk to someone. It's getting harder and harder in our world to talk to people, but it's really a critical factor as you develop your relationships with your customers. Being fully prepared, it kind of goes back to what we talked about earlier about notating your accounts. One of the keys that we see of businesses that are trying to stall in paying you is they will do whatever they can sometimes to muddy the waters. And if you're not fully prepared as to what exactly the situation is, and all the details that go into the account, you are putting yourself at a disadvantage when you go into that conversation. And that's why it's critical that before you make contact with someone, if it's in reference to them owing you money, get the facts of what's happened on the case so that when you step into that, you'll know what is a true objection and what is probably a stall. And then, you know, one of the, I guess you could call it negotiations 101 that we talk to people about. When we talk to customers that owe money, we simply, there's two things. Number one, they owe the money, okay? Number two, you're entitled to be paid for it, so you should be asking for the full payment period, okay? Do not, if they hem and haw about it, don't come back with a counteroffer until you hear what their particular offer is on a situation. So basically that last bullet was make sure that you don't throw out an offer to resolve it because your offer may be worse than what they were willing to do. So have them make an offer if they're offering to resolve something. Okay, Dad, and then I think we can move down to the next one.
Well, I think we have a poll question on this real quick. And
the poll question should be interrelated is how often do you reduce? There it is. How often do you settle an account for less? Oh, Amanda, I took your moment. Go get it. Less of me is good.
We got answers coming in here, so let's see what they're saying.
All right. Yeah, we're very interested in this, knowing how often anybody ever reduces balances. So I'm looking forward to that. And in the interest of time, I'm going to go to the next slide while we'll wait for all the results to come in. Fair. This is relatively quick, this particular slide. If you take anything away from this one slide, this is it. Ready? You're not the bank. You are a provider of a service as a staffing organization to help an organization do that. You have your terms and agreements. They owe you money, and the longer that they go without paying you that money, 100% of people never negotiate, by the way. That's pretty cool. That's pretty good. You're not a bank. Do not carry these balances on for months and months and months. That's called free financing. I don't know about you, but I finance a vehicle or two in my life, and I have some young adult kids who I help out with, and none of my banks are very forgiving if I don't pay on time. So there's consequences associated with that. They provide an opportunity for me to drive their vehicles. They give me terms, and I have to meet those terms or there's consequences. So we're going to sell back to you that you understand your customer's challenges. However, you provided a service, and you're going to stick to your deadlines. Now, the other moving parts that we've discussed come into play here, but you're not a bank, and so we always encourage our customers to have deadlines, hard deadlines, and move along in life. So,
well,
very good.
Just Brandon, if I may pop in and just say, what we train our people to do as well is to make sure that they are offering up suggestions as to, is your customer looking for other sources of funding? I mean, listen, in the Medicare example, can you go borrow money from a relative if that's what you have to do? I mean, but there are other places that they potentially could go get money at instead of leaning on you for essentially being the bank. Okay, and I think that now we were, let's look at the poll, Brad. Wow, holy smokes, never. How often do you settle? I'm impressed.
Well, you didn't hear when I got excited about that?
Yeah. I missed that. That's awesome. That is awesome. All right, so
we got to wrap it up here soon.
Yeah, we got to move them along. So age of an account, you're going to see why age is critical. And this is the one steady thing that holds true in all the years of being in this particular business is that the older an account is, the more difficult it is going to be to collect. So with that, what I will tell you is this, there was a collectability of commercial debt. I should say this, the collectability of commercial debt essentially was a certain percentage 30 years ago. That percentage is less now than it used to be. But what you will see by this particular slide is essentially this. Even an account that is 6 months beyond terms, the collectability of that account drops drastically. And clearly you can see as it gets down to be a year plus old, it really becomes problematic as far as your ability to collect on an account. And that's where the whole thing about becoming proactive with your activity is really a critical matter. And Brad, did we do a poll? Were we thinking about a poll here?
Yep, we do.
Well,
I'll go ahead and open it if you'd like.
Brad, did you have something you wanted to say beforehand?
Yeah, I'll let Amanda open the poll and read it, and then I'll chime in real quick.
Okay. Poll is open, so please submit your answers. At what accounts receivable age do you consider turning an account over to collections?
We've kind of hedged the bets here. Now, just for what it's worth, department, this debt collection forecasting, you see the percentages of month 1, 2, 3, 6, 9, 12, 24, and the recovery values. That is not a Kane and Weiner slide. That's an industry driven from the, I believe it was the CLLA or the CCA put this out, and they do it collectively along the lines of well over 5,000 agencies throughout the United States that weigh in on dollars, age, and the collectability of the ages. So this is something that's out there, and it's proven. So what we're saying is don't hesitate beyond your demands. You get to a certain point, and it's time to move it forward. Wow, there you go. Frank,
yeah,
what is the result of that today?
67% over 120 days, yeah, and beyond.
There you go. Hey, so our recommendation, just from our perspective historically, is this. There's different terms for different industries along the way, but what we say to all of our clients is we would like you to have a process in line to where you've sent that out. Once it starts aging, you validate that there's no viable disputes that they can hang back on you. And then at a point of about 90 days is a pretty significant amount of time for them to have worked with you and then hand it over. So ours anywhere as early as 30 to 60, but 90 days seems to be very valuable. Unfortunately, and I worked for a credit firm that did global credit insurance, and the United States lags behind all other countries interrelated to age of debt. The average age of debt in the UK and most throughout Europe is about 30 to 60 days when it goes to collections. The United States is anywhere from 6 to 9 months. So help yourself by the recovery of that debt. The small percentage that you're going to pay your agency to help you out on that is far greater than zero. I can guarantee you when nobody's able to collect any, that value that you were being charged is still zero. Slicing off a small percentage to let the professionals take over after you've done everything is really, really important. All right, we're down to the final slides here. So here it is, handing it over versus closing it out. You know, closing it out internally doesn't mean you don't have the right to then send it to collections. Some clients prefer to keep their AR balances open until collections has run its course, and some close out their books, then send it to collections, and then anything that comes in is a windfall. So when should I close the file? Well, that's really up to your policies and procedures and based on your accounting functions. But what it means to us is when should you close that file? Really look at the balance. You know, if somebody owes you just a couple of $100, you know, it's probably worth sending to a collection agency, but it's worth considering not and just writing it off at that point, because that struggle becomes real and that balance starts to it's traditional in our world. It's the small balances that cause the biggest problems. Okay, so figure out what works best for you. Our recommendation is that closing a file and sending it to collections should happen anywhere between 60 and 90 days. Okay. So that lends into when should I send to collections. As soon as you've figured out that they are no longer going to pay you in spite of promises and broken promises, and or when that date eclipses. So it's kind of a moving part. If somebody's working with you and truly paying you and you want to continue to facilitate those payments, you should not send them to collections. If somebody is continuing to carry on the procrastination in paying you, you should send that to collections and have a hard drop date of 90 days. So you should weigh all those factors in. The other one that comes to us is, well, should I just go sue them right away? Yes and no. And I'm going to tell you a secret. We have internal collections. Most agencies either have internal legal that follows the collections, which we do, and some, if most, will work with outside counsel. So there's a process. Our recommendation is for our clients who just want to go legal, we can do that, but we also try to educate them on, look, if we can put it into collections, we're going to work it 3 to 6 times a month, a week, a period, where an attorney is going to get it, send a letter, sit on it for a while, and then send it out. That has value, but the number of attempts and the collectability of any disputes that would come in on the front end is better to happen in the collection environment than the legal environment. So our recommendation is to put it into collections, let the collectors call, send letters, send demands, send texts, send emails, recover it there. And it's typically about a 2/3 cheaper, meaning it's not going to cost as much than if you actually go to litigation and stretching litigation out with the tie-ups in courts. And especially with the courts now that have been closed for the last 60 days in most parts, that backlog just got deeper. So litigate where you know that there's no chance of recovery in collections because this person is just certifiable, but always give it a shot, then we can move it into litigation. Last but not least, when supporting information, what supporting information would I need to send? We get this question pretty much from every client who we engage with the first time. We need the basic information. We need the name, the address, the phone number, the amount due, any breakdown of invoice when that amount was due, any supporting contracts that you have, especially with signatures, are valuable, extremely valuable. And the date of the last invoice, because the date of the last invoice is when we can start accruing interest on your behalf. And we usually utilize the interest as a negotiation aspect to not jeopardize the principal value. So that means we're taking whatever they owe, accelerating it by legal interest. And if we need to negotiate, we can always work that off. That way you get your principal back. And that, my friends, wraps it up. And we're just under the wire here. We have a few moments for questions and answers. I'm going to hand it back to Amanda at this stage.
Sounds great. Thank you so much. So you'll see a slide here that has both Brad and Frank's contact information. If you have additional questions, after looking through this, you look through your AR and you have, accounts that you're questioning whether they should be turned to collections, these two gentlemen can certainly help you in that area should you need it. So feel free to reach out to them. As we kind of wrap things up, if there are any questions that you have at the moment, please go ahead and submit a chat or Q&A. One question that has come in, Brad or Frank, if you can discuss a little bit about when you're discussing collections with an account, do you find that negative credit reporting or threat of moving to collections or legal is beneficial in any way for a client to try before turning it over?
Brad, I'll field my take on this. It is beneficial, but here's the bottom line rule. You don't want to threaten action that you're not going to be willing to take, okay? We certainly have customers that want us to credit report the account. Now, there are some stipulations. In order to credit report, you have to have certain information, such as the date of birth or social security number, in order to actually report something to the credit bureaus. But, at the end of the day, threaten action that you're willing to take. Don't threaten action that you're not willing to take, because that only hurts your reputation.
Good point. And when you say, what is it that the credit bureaus all need? I get that question a lot as a director of credit here about credit reporting and how that works. Can you touch on that quickly?
Generally speaking, when we're talking about on the commercial side, we can credit report accounts, essentially. But on the consumer side, in order to credit report, in order for the bureaus to accept it, you have to have at least a social security security number and or date of birth. And that was a rule that I think came into play in 2017. The obvious reason is you want to make sure that you're credit reporting the right individual, if it is an individual.
Right, and I think in most cases it would be a business that our clients would be trying to do a credit report on,
mm-hmm.
with a company name and address.
That's a little different. I mean, typically with that, when you're reporting accounts, for instance, our organization reports to, on the commercial side, to like Experian, to Dun & Bradstreet, to Cortera. So if we get a commercial account, we can report that to one of those bureaus without any, obviously it's a business, it's not a person, so we don't need a social security number or date of birth. But if it's a business, we obviously have to set it up accordingly so that we report it to the credit bureau. Because it really is up to you to decide whether you want it to be credit reported. And there is value in credit reporting because it is a consequence of non-payment, is that you're going to have a negative credit reporting. And whether you're a business or whether you're an individual, it does hold weight these days, especially with everybody on their phones being able to find out what their credit score is on the personal side. And of course, it impacting on a commercial side your ability to potentially, it can impact your credit rating. So.
Very good.
Mm-hmm.
Any final thoughts before we wrap it up?
Well, feel free to reach out to us if you have any questions. We'd be happy to do what we can to help you out.
And thank you all for attending.
Wonderful. Thank you, Brad and Frank, for sharing your information on best practices for collecting on a delinquent account. Watch for information on our next webinar sessions. We hold them monthly, and you'll find information on TRICOM's website. We will have a recording of this available on our website as well for anyone who would like to share it or view it again. Thank you so much for your time, and have a wonderful afternoon.
Bye now.